Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of Saving Agnes by Rachel Cusk, narrated by Jenny Sterlin. This work is copyrighted 1993 by Rachel Cusk. This recording is copyrighted 1998 by Recorded Books Incorporated. Agnes Day, sub-editor, suburbanite, failure extraordinaire. Though chronically confused by life's most basic equations, she has been able to pass herself off as a success with the barest minimum of cosmetic assistance. Beneath the fiction, however, the burden of truth is becoming harder to bear. And now, Saving Agnes.
Chapter 1. The house, like the party, was subsiding. It didn't lurch or tilt titanically, crockery and silverware crashing to the floor, women in tight taffeta dresses flung screaming across the room. Like the party, it wasn't a large-scale Hollywood affair. As yet, the only evidence of its sinking was a crack, a long, narrow wound in the sitting room wall, and Agnes Day felt that it presaged a destiny altogether more menacing. She stood at the foot of the stairs, where a handful of stragglers, having not long ago heroically resisted the 2 o'clock exodus, now lingered with an air of having in some way been cheated. On the far side of the room, one or two people stood immobile in the landscape of bottles and ashtrays, overturned candles and shattered glass, of wine pools banked by little white hillocks of salt and fringed with crumbled cigarette packets, like contorted statues in an abstract sculpture park. She realized there was no one here she wanted to talk to, no one she could even bear talking to.
"The condemned man ate a hearty breakfast," said Merlin cheerfully, passing her by as he trawled the room with a large black bin liner. Agnes headed for the stairs, where a candle was lying felled in a pool of its own wax on the carpet. Merlin and Nina had, rightly, she now admitted, been opposed to her candle scheme, but the house had looked so lovely by candlelight, so aglow with anticipation and promise, that she had forced them to yield. Merlin had submitted gratifyingly swiftly, Nina less pliant, but always with a ready definition of democracy to hand, new majority rule when she saw it. They had seen it as a whim, Agnes knew, a flimsy floating thing which scientists might examine under a microscope. But if that were what it was, she was full of them, riddled with terminal caprice. She toured her disease like a schizophrenic commuter, trudging back and forth between how things were and how she wanted them to be. The candles belonged to the latter world, and it was a place she habitually visited alone. Roaming through the gloaming, she had almost been happy. Agnes Day paused at the foot of the stairs. Her guest looked wild-eyed and nocturnal, something seen in a nature documentary. Some people in one corner were puncturing beer cans with ballpoint pens. A geyser of brown liquid foamed over the curtains. Nina was lounging on a nearby sofa, engaged in conversation. "Look," she sighed impatiently. "Women don't necessarily want men to accept their hideous physical proclivities. We need a secret life. It's part of our autonomy. In fact, I can't think of anything worse than some post-feminist prat fawning over my body hair." "Not at all," cried the recipient of this lecture, apparently undeterred by it. He had something on his upper lip which, on closer inspection, Agnes saw to be a moustache. "You shouldn't be embarrassed about it. In fact, I think there's nothing more beautiful than a woman with hairy armpits." Nina rested her head on two fingers, pointed at her temple like a revolver, and rolled her eyes at Agnes, who changed course with grim determination and fled up the stairs. In the bathroom, she peered into the mirror, as if trying to see something beyond what was there. Her lipstick had seeped into spiky tendrils around her mouth, clinging like a sea anemone to the porous surface of her face. Agnes met her own eyes and saw their expression was fearful. She rummaged in the cupboard above the sink and began to draw a new red smile over the flagging grimace already there. Halfway through, her lower lip gleaming like a bloodied crescent moon, she stopped and allowed herself to submit to a wave of despair. What was the point? How, when John had taken all point with him, packing it neatly between a sweater and a book, perhaps, could she be expected to care? She looked in the mirror, hoping to compound the tragedy by reading its desolation in her face. Her orphaned lip, however, lent her grieving features an annoyingly comical aspect. She deferred further rumination while carefully drawing in the upper bow. She emerged a few minutes later to harvest the fruit of her labours. Someone was standing outside. Someone she hadn't seen before. The light from the bathroom swung interrogatively over his face as she opened the door and barreled straight into him. And she saw that look in his eyes as he saw her. The look of surprised appreciation, of suggestion and intent. That speaking glance she had sometimes felt she would do anything for, just to feel again its comforting implication of desire. She apologized and smiled, and somehow a conversation was begun. The slightly distasteful fact that they had met outside the bathroom could be seen as rather humorous, she thought, if presented in the right way. She planned it as she saw him taking every cue faultlessly, like a professional. "This is how we met," she would say. Chapter 2. Agnes and Nina and Merlin met at university. Or at least that was what Agnes said. Merlin, prizing information over intrigue, said they met at Oxford. Nina said they met at college. Agnes preferred her own version of events, although not, as might have been imagined, for its lack of bias towards cultural elitism in either quarter. To her, such ellipses contained a world of social possibility which could not be overlooked, so "we met at university," she would say, or of some fleeting stranger waving to her across a crowded room, "Oh, just someone I knew at university." "When I was at university," she would say, eyes modestly lowered, head tilted slightly forwards, so that her panicked and prurient companion would endure several agonizing moments of uncertainty. Was it Hull or Harvard? He, for it was invariably a he, couldn't tell, but now that she'd mentioned it, he simply had to know. Was she beautiful and brainy? Was his cup about to run over? Almost unable to bear the possibility of disappointment, and unaware that his discomfort was standard procedure, he would somehow stammer, "Where did you study?" Agnes, with a now quite confident show of shame and humility, would murmur, "Oxford." Low, but not so low as to be in any danger of being misheard, and then would look for a brief moment imploringly into her inquisitor's eye. Once or twice, when Agnes had left the irresistible bait of her undisclosed place of education hanging tantalizingly in the air, her companion had merely smiled slyly and inquired, "Oxford or Cambridge?" The admission would take on a very different tone then, and while Agnes was quick to condemn these specimens as offenders against the rules of attraction, she would eventually concede that they must also be the unfortunate living examples of that breed she had often heard spoken about, but whose aversion she had humbly never considered would devolve upon her, who disliked intelligent women. While none of them then could agree on where they met, the plain fact of their mutual liking was less open to dispute. Nina and Agnes had been friends first and had met in the early weeks of their first year. Nina, freshly emerged from the dust cloud of a genteel Surrey upbringing, was a radical supporter of anything which promised to undermine it, while Agnes naturally gravitated towards things which bore at least a resemblance, however vague, to the small collection of known quantities accumulated during her East Anglian youth. In the event, their unlikely convergence was precipitated by Nina's accosting Agnes in a hallway and inviting her to a women's group meeting. "Women's group?" Agnes had replied suspiciously. "Well, yes. Okay. Is that where you all sit around and talk about diets and boyfriends and things?" At the time, Nina had found this jest hilarious, and had had ample opportunity over the subsequent years to ruminate upon the possibility that Agnes might have meant it seriously. It wasn't long before the arrival of Merlin, a bouncing 11-stone mathematician, completed their family group, and even strengthened their commitment to one another. Many were the times Agnes and Nina concealed their quarrels for his sake, for he doted on them both. Merlin, although quiet and bespectacled, was possessed of the rare ability to make people like him with very little apparent effort on his part. This was possibly owing to a certain air of impartiality, an asocial, asexual calmness in his nature, which never failed to attract those beset by insecurities concerning their own frenetically social and sexual selves, who, it might be added, in those days of identity crisis, constituted the great majority of his peers. While Merlin appeared not to mind his involuntary popularity, Agnes and Nina took it upon themselves to protect him from the wasteful wiles of moaners and whingers. They discouraged the distressed individuals regularly to be found taking up tenancy in his room, whisked him away from under the noses of those attempting to waylay him with their problems on his way to the library, and even, upon occasion, salvaged him from the jaws of women who, wounded by less liberated loves, sought to assuage their hurt in the safety of Merlin's enlightened sensibilities. So Merlin went unscarred, if uninitiated, through the three difficult years of weaning from adolescence. He frolicked untrammeled in Elysian groves of quantum mechanics and chaos, while Nina and Agnes dealt with the hard realities of English literature. They listened patiently, their hands dusty with medieval prose, their foreheads smudged with 19th-century hardship, while Merlin spoke sweetly of the frothy surface of time and the vexing disappearance of Schrödinger's cat. It was not, then, without some surprise, and perhaps the smallest quantity of resentment, that as they emerged some years later into the harsh light and noise of a brutal London and anxiously watched Merlin take his first faltering steps, they clearly saw him break into a confident run straight into the arms of a multi-million-pound financial institution, a company car, and a salary for which Elizabeth Bennet would have left Darcy's dinner burning in the oven. Agnes and Nina listened nervously as Merlin debated the various advantages of living in Chelsea, Hampstead, or Kensington, then took to reading the Hackney Gazette and the Acton Observer, in the hope that such publications, if left lying around, might cultivate in him a taste for the distinctive flavour of the more modest boroughs. This practice, however, was short-lived, for as pleasant as the world seemed when reflected in the Merton mirror, it offered little opportunity for gainful employment. Although Agnes, it must be said, often spent illicit hours poring over their yellowed pages, lost in the twilight subterrane of out-of-date local intrigue and small ads, of macabre deeds, petty thievery and sleazy domestic violence, of truth that was stranger indeed than the fiction of bombs, wars and global decay that she observed nightly. She read about a woman who left her husband's corpse rotting on the sofa, claiming she didn't know he was dead. A man who, catching his wife with a man he took to be her lover, shot them both and then shot himself.
Someone divorcing his wife after discovering she'd been feeding him cat food for the last 10 years. I was saving him money, the woman protested. I used the extra to buy nylons, bit of lipstick, you know. Agnes imagined them, these borough dwellers, packed into honeycombed tower blocks and desolate shopping malls, their territories orbiting around Belgravia and Knightsbridge and Soho, like strange satellites round a mysterious sun. She was fascinated by their fearlessness. There were days when she sat until the afternoon died into darkness, her eyes raking the classified pages in search of she knew not what. Models wanted for mail order catalogue, commis chef required, earn hundreds from home, own transportation essential. They ended up living in Highbury, or at least that was what Agnes said. Merlin, taking for his reference the nearest conurbation, said they lived in Finsbury Park. Nina said they lived in the Arsenal. What Nina's claim lacked in glamour, it made up for in accuracy. They did indeed live in the Arsenal, a tiny grid of quiet streets possessing an unusually parochial charm for what they all claimed was central London. The Arsenal, however, although dangerously near the borders, was undeniably in Agnes's Highbury, and the two friends were happy to discover they lived in such close proximity. Alas, it was Merlin, insisting as he did on the windswept reaches of Finsbury Park, who dwelt in error. For though it was but half a mile away, this barren region of concrete and cast iron, of clotting traffic and petrol-heavy air, of desolate pavements overrun with skulking dogs and whirling litter cyclones, of filthy strings of shops selling only what nobody wanted to buy, was, and on this Agnes insisted, a world apart. The house belonged to Merlin's uncle Dan, but Merlin's preferment displayed scant consciousness of the time-honoured rituals of heirloom and inheritance. Dan deserted the property like a precipitant rat at the first sign of listing, when rumours of the street subsidence were still but rumours. The council had agreed to purchase the house at the end of a 2-year period, by which time, they assured him with what appeared to be complacency, it was certain to be uninhabitable. And Dan was partially comforted to find in Merlin a tenant prepared to pay handsomely for the pleasure of witnessing the property's decline. The proximity of the Arsenal football ground went some way towards recompensing Merlin for his pains, and although the value of this bonus had been calculated without his incumbent flatmates in mind, they at least were relieved that he seemed to have abandoned his dreams of security guards and private swimming pools. What it lacked in elegant accoutrements, the house made up for in symbolic value. For it was, after all, their first. Like its occupants, 14 Elwood Street was detached from its neighbours. Merlin claimed there was an exiled Cameroonian prince living in disgrace next door. But while Agnes and Nina had seen for themselves the broken windows, overflowing bins, and constant stream of unsavoury visitors that paid testimony to the latter part of this statement, they had no evidence as to the veracity of the former. Once Merlin had started his job, Agnes and Nina spent their days scrubbing and sweeping and purging like symbiotic housewives. Within a fortnight, however, Nina found a job on a local newspaper, which shifting of the household's employment ratio meant that home improvements were relegated to weekends. While the democratic process exempted Agnes from days of lonesome toil, it did not see fit to replace this occupation with any more productive form of employment. She spent days wandering the streets of her unfamiliar home, and was eventually driven to go into different newsagents, buying 3 papers a day, just so that she could talk to someone. On one of these social forays, she encountered her next-door neighbour, the erstwhile prince of the Cameroons, rooting in his own rubbish bin, as if in the hope of scavenging something that he,
as a monarchist spendthrift might have tossed away half-finished. "Morning," Agnes called out, driven by pity and desperation to an attempt at human kindness. The man looked up and stared at her. Presently, he grinned and indicated a battered lime-green Cortina parked outside the house.
"Joyride," he said. "Me and you."
"No, thank you," said Agnes smartly as she walked on, chilled by this untimely encounter with derangement.
"Fuck you,"
she suddenly heard him shout behind her. She quickened her pace tearfully as the cry wheeled in the air like a vulture, blocking out the sun. "Fuck you." Agnes liked to believe there was some good to be gleaned from every situation, however bad it might seem. But when she had been working for a month at Diplomat's Week magazine, she realized the higher purpose of the benevolent universe was taking a little longer than usual to reveal itself. She had been employed, for reasons she was not yet able to ascertain, as assistant editor of this illustrious weekly, but soon came to feel that she was not so much assisting as getting in the way. The pain of this suspicion would become particularly acute when, sitting in her overheated office, she would find herself transfixed by the arthritic motion of the clock on the wall, and forgetting for a moment that her imprisonment was owed to an act of will, rather than one of international terrorism, would become tearful at the thought that perhaps the rest of her adult life was to be wished away thus. A hostage, then, only to fortune, and determined from the start swiftly to make good her escape, Agnes saw little point in absorbing herself in the dull round of tasks which befell her, and still less in cultivating meaningful relationships with her guards. The editor, Jean, was a grim and tight-lipped woman, whose all-encompassing role as high priestess of form and slave to detail meant that Agnes was ever within spitting distance of her wrath, a proximity made more terrible by the fact of Jean's having devised an office system either so complex or so irrational that only she could understand it. The blame for Agnes's complete failure to grasp any one of its labyrinthian tenets could therefore have been apportioned to one of several quarters, but her inferior position in a hierarchy which seemed to her to be riddled with the same predestined injustices as that of her family rendered her wholly accountable. "Don't buck the system, Barbara," Jean would cry, as Agnes was discovered performing emergency surgery on a filing cabinet so full that it appeared to be vomiting sheaves of paper. Barbara was the name of Agnes's predecessor, whose ghost evidently still walked for Jean. "I was only trying to help," Agnes would rejoin. But Jean, who wore the look of one doing things for the war effort, had long since formed the opinion that there was a saboteur in their midst and was not to be fooled by any such protestations of innocence. Conspiratorial solace soon appeared in the form of Jean's personal assistant, Greta, who returned from holiday just as Agnes was beginning to wonder if she would ever return to waking life. Greta was certainly personal, to the point of rudeness with her employer, but Agnes was cheered to see that there was someone who was of even less assistance than herself. On first encountering her, Agnes had been somewhat alarmed by Greta's transatlantic accent and air hostess smile, but she soon learned that Greta had a curious allure, an ability to arouse unlikely behaviour in those around her, which lent her a strange and devilish beauty. "This city is bizarre," she sighed, when arriving in the office one morning. "I was crossing the road over there when some guy in a truck drinking a can of beer stopped at the lights and just spat a whole mouthful all over me." The beer stain adorning the front of her jacket bore witness to her story, and she waited, doe-eyed and credulous, for an explanation, while Agnes and Jean assured her that such occurrences were far from commonplace. which admission seemed only to baffle her further. "The guy in the truck," she said finally, "he kind of reminded me of my boyfriend back home." Greta was a Ukrainian-Canadian, and if a marriage between these two cultures seemed unlikely, their brief encounter in the form of Greta was unregrettable. She had come to London 6 months earlier, and despite finding the city to be drab, tedious, and inhospitable in the extreme, saw no reason why she should leave. In addition to her unconventional style of dress, she favoured garish colours and dressed as if in preparation for a carnival or costume ball. Clownish stripes combined with military epaulets, Elizabethan ruffs with rakish ponchos. Greta's voluptuous beauty and unsuspecting nature invited much attention. Most of it, as far as Agnes could see, unwelcome. "I'm on a diet," she announced one lunchtime. "Why?" queried Agnes, amazed that she should contemplate such an activity when her life already seemed to be in constant peril. "Oh, some guy came up to me in the street last night and said I was a fat cow," said Greta cheerfully. "He suggested I might try and lose some weight." As if it were infectious, Agnes too began to discover the discomfort of strangers, but the weightiness for her of such encounters could not be so easily lost. She began to attract the attentions of the mad, the vagrant, and those down on their luck in a manner she hoped was no relation to recognition. Once a soft touch for these ragged moralists who inveigled her into sparing them her change, Agnes began to cross the road, begging for some change in her circumstances. She witnessed her expulsion from the civilized world daily as she completed the arduous journey to the misleadingly named Finchley Central, where the offices of Diplomats Week clung to the city's edge like a penitent clifftop suicide, hoping against hope that someone, anyone remotely sane, would stay on the train beyond Highgate. But by the time they reached Camden Town, the majority of those whom she could not picture stealing her wallet had long since disembarked, and as the train blasted through the topsoil into the charmless overground world of East Finchley, the last feverish, pulsating remnants of the mad morning rush were gone. Until that moment, Agnes usually managed to sustain the appearance of a thrusting young professional running on a tight schedule. But then someone switched on the lights, pulled off the mask, revealed the pretender for exactly who she was. Women fanned themselves and fainted in the aisles in dismay. Men in tight tailcoats stood up, red-faced, and waved their programs demanding redress, for she was none other than Agnes Day, sub-editor, suburbanite, failure extraordinaire. Chapter 3. Agnes Day was her real name, but this seemed to surprise no one other than herself. For her own part, she could not conjure up a single plausible reason why anyone should want to inflict a name such as that upon an innocent person. Agnes had, in fact, been the name of her father's mother, and while most of the time she chose to overlook the rather pedestrian logic this coincidence implied, in moments of fear at the world's cruelty she was forced to concede that to have inherited little from this lady other than her appellatory misfortune constituted something of a lucky escape. As a child, Agnes had been imaginative, a word often used to explain the character of a compulsive liar, and had enjoyed frequent changes of identity, which, as far as she could see, it would have cost the small group of people who counted as her world in those days little to honour. A few times, in truth, they had attempted to humour her delightful precocities, their faces taut at first with suppressed smiles, and later with irritation. But the rapid turnover of transmogrification often left them standing. "Bathsheba, could you pass the salt?" her father would politely inquire. "Boadicea!" Agnes would cry. which exhortation would usually rend from her less indulgent mother, a plea along the lines of, "Oh, for God's sake, Agnes." Agnes would then be forced again to correct the form of her address, and would inevitably be rewarded with a stinging backside and the liberty to retire to her room as soon as she liked. As Agnes approached puberty, her identity crisis, escaping the contemptuous adolescent pruning of all things childish, grew, along with the other nascent buds of her evolving worldview, from a whimsical fantasy into an issue of earth-shattering importance. A rejection of all things outlandish in favour of the ephemeral trappings of pure conformity was only natural. And although she soon lost her taste for elaborate nomenclature, her desperate need for acceptability outpaced it. Seeing the Dominiques, Gemmas, and Antoinettes at school become more beautiful, clever, and confident than the rest, and seeing also that she had not accompanied them in this transformation, merely confirmed what she already knew to be true, that what would have been success by any other name was fast becoming failure by her own. The adult world being impervious to the tender-hearted miseries of youth, and assuming that identity was a more or less fixed matter, whose flaws were the responsibility of no one other than their owner, Agnes knew that hers would be a solitary struggle. Wishing to spare those who did not really deserve any more careful consideration than they had shown in naming her, and secretly fearful of straying too far from the terms on which her worldly existence so far had seemed to depend, she chose her own middle name, Grace. Even her elders, in all their irrational mystery, could not object to such a choice, as they themselves had selected the name from all the thousands which had haunted her mother's bulging belly like wispy little girl ghosts as runner-up. Why Grace, superior as she so evidently was, had not won this early contest, Agnes could not imagine. But her battle for reinstatement second time around looked set for victory. To Agnes's dumbfoundment, her parents did not object to her plan, and even humoured her so far as to suggest measures for its smoother implementation. Her mother advised that she try the name at home first to see if she liked it, and Agnes, always glad of an opportunity to disguise apprehension with obedience, made a fine show of reluctant agreement. For a while, then, Grace was an honoured guest in their house, a favoured foster child who emanated sunshine and laughter wherever she went. Her pronouncements were solemnly heard, her opinions sought out, her health and happiness the priority of the household. Only her brother, the more prosaically named Tom, continued to refer to Agnes in a manner not entirely respectful to the dead. "Let's say Agnes," he would declare as the family were bowed for Grace before supper, or, if Grace declined to join him in a game of cards, "Don't put on those airs and Agneses with me," would be his scornful riposte. Tom missed Agnes and had little time for her double, but would certainly not have shared this information with either of them. Inevitably, as the days wore on, it fell to Grace's lot to do the share of household chores which had been Agnes's, and which had been temporarily forestalled while her arrival was still a novelty. There was also a portion of ill-humour and reprimand to be claimed, and it surprised Grace to discover that it was indistinguishable from that which had befallen Agnes. Gradually Grace began to feel disenchanted with her new home, especially when she contemplated in the mirror the toll it was taking on her looks. She was not the ravishing creature of fantasy she once had been, and nor did she inspire the love and admiration she once had known. She began, in short, to consider taking her leave, and although the change was so gradual as almost to elude their notice, the family one day realized that Agnes was with them once more. Their joy at this discovery did not console their prodigal daughter. Agnes was convinced that Grace had been driven away by her family's ill treatment, not to mention their incurable tendency to call her Agnes. And under such circumstances, she could ill afford any pleasure at their very evident relief to have her back with them. Tom's cunning wordplay, however, remained, and enjoyed frequent airings in a context which Agnes could only later begin to see, with a controllable quantity of grief, as family humour. It would have surprised them, no doubt, to learn that some part of Agnes had been irretrievably lost through this episode, and though it would never have occurred to her to blame them, she sometimes wondered why the proliferation of selves she would have liked to be and lives she would have liked to live remained locked inside her, prisoners of utmost secrecy and shame. And while it taught her that reality meant failure, ugliness and self-contempt, it also instilled in her the belief that the good in her was but fiction. As she grew older and encountered the approbation of friends and lovers, this fiction became ever more elaborate, until she feared that one day she would crumble beneath the weight of her deception and lose all that she most valued. Once Agnes had mourned Grace, but eventually she came to loathe and fear her, for she had taken everything that she once loved in herself, every particle of hope and optimism and beauty, and made it false. Agnes did not create Grace. It was Grace who created Agnes, slapped her together with the dross and scraps she did not want herself. Agnes saw her sometimes, the model on the cover of a magazine, the byline on a witty news feature, the laughing glamorous figure in a red sports car driven by an adoring boyfriend. I wish it were me, she would think. It should have been me. Chapter 4. Agnes Day painted her face and starved herself. She shaved her legs and plucked her eyebrows and scrubbed the gravelly flesh on her thighs with a mitt of similar texture. She moisturized here and desiccated there, purged her skin of odor and oil, and then force-fed it with creams and sprays, as if hoping that one day it would give off of its own accord the exotic fragrance and softness which were now but briefly borrowed. Occasionally she would bleach the rather unsightly shadow of dark hairs that fell across her upper lip, a process which, albeit temporarily, necessitated that she sport an ebullient white cream moustache over the meagre but offending dark one. Sometimes it seemed to her as if her body were in a constant state of revolt, maliciously engendering odour and ugliness, coarse hair sprouting through every pore, flesh puckering here and sagging there. She was vigilant and artful in stemming protuberance and decay, but subversion was all around. Only recently she had discovered a horrifyingly virulent crop of dark hairs on the backs of her marbled, or as romantic poets would perhaps rather, marble thighs. The fact that this discovery had come only days after she read of a similar complaint in a woman's magazine was, she thought, a sublime if unsettling coincidence. The magazine had suggested waxing or electrolysis as the most efficacious remedy. But to Agnes, these things were redolent of mystery and pain, and were more easily applied, in her mind, to the writing of great poetry than to the backs of the legs. Contrary to appearances, Agnes would have liked nothing better than to be natural, for she regarded this incessant pruning and weeding as burdensome. She did not see it as her womanly business to pluck and purge and preen. Rather, it was with the aim of securing for herself what nature omitted generously to bestow that she occupied herself thus. She regarded Nina's bare face and downy legs with more envy than contempt,
and, with a degree of humility which would have surprised no one more than herself had she been aware of it, strove not to please others, but merely not to disgust them. So it was that Agnes, knowing herself to be a fake, and being fatally attracted to the unforgiving expert sex, spent her days in mortal fear of discovery. Guiltily, she hid the tools of her loathsome trade. Filled with self-hatred, she left her bed, on those sparse but nonetheless harrowing occasions when there was someone sharing it, to scrub from her the unnatural stench of the night's activities. She would meet her own eyes in the mirror, and would see them fill with tears as they contemplated the red and blotchy character of their surrounds. Before she numbly set about superimposing with artifice the glowing and satisfied visage the evening had somehow failed to supply, she sometimes felt the hatred almost reaching down and dissolving her fear. Something wild and indecipherable had taken hold. For had she been discovered then, bare and trembling in the cold bathroom, all the acrimony in the world would have been but confirmation. She derived a strange comfort from knowing she was as naked as the truth. Few, then, would have perceived that Agnes Day felt less vanity than guilt as she readied herself for an assignation in Central Islington. Her destination was the stranger encountered by the bathroom door, and the brief memory she had of his quiet and critical bearing informed her that her preparations would require exceptional assiduity if he was also to become her destiny. She met the glance of her bare face like that of a stranger, and eyed her naked body with the indifference of a bored husband blunted by years of custom. Robed and daubed, however, she recognized herself once more, and scrutinized her reflection, front, side, and back, as if in preparation for attack. She wore her hair long, a trick intended to clear up any queries as to her gender. As a child, she had often been mistaken for a boy, and although now she felt she possessed sufficient evidence to refute any such claims, the memory of those who once doubted lingered uncomfortably at the back of her mind. As it was still light, Agnes walked the distance, crossing Highbury fields just as the sun raked over the soft pastel sky and disappeared, leaving it scarred with violet welts. Boys kicked balls and wheeled aimlessly on bikes, their cries fluttering up through the trees like fugitive birds, their shadows long and skinny as poles. "All right, darling," someone shouted to her. A row of teenagers sat on a bench like crows on a telegraph wire, blowing artless clouds of smoke from summer cigarettes through their gappy, grinning mouths. Agnes passed behind a tree and used her temporary occlusion to tug at her skirt, wishing it were not so short. She felt suddenly vulgar with her cardboard face and gashed, bleeding mouth, shown up by the delicate evening, the whisper of twilight, the soft texture of leaf and sky. Her perfume clawed at the translucent scent of flowers and grass until she felt almost nauseous. She passed through the park and regained the thundering roadside. A lorry roared by her with a hot rush of diesel. The sudden commotion was deafening. She stood on the concrete pavement in terror. People looked at her as they shoved past, some with annoyance, others, the men, with a kind of sneering admiration. She thought of him waiting for her, and for a moment the whole predictable shoot of their putative future opened out there on the roadside. A saga of love and loss, a lightning cruise around places she had seen before. At that moment she would have stayed there, paralyzed, until dogs cocked their legs against her. But the oddity of her predicament soon forced itself upon her, and she began to walk. Perhaps, after all, he could save her. Perhaps he would. He was late, but Agnes had learned not to mind that.
Indeed, she expected nothing less. She sat at a table out of sight of the door, but perfectly angled by a window, which afforded a view of the street, so that she would receive information of his arrival early enough to be able to greet it with studied indifference. Outside, night had fallen, and she found her gaze wandering into the darkened street, where a decrepit neon sign over the laundrette opposite read, "We clean curtains and lovers." She got on well enough with anticipation. In her view, the experience of things before they happened generally provided the most pleasing version of events. It occurred to her that believing in anticipation was not unlike believing in God, another of her covert vices. It was the same drift of soul and mind towards perfection, and to Agnes the thought of perceiving the world without this dimension was to see only shadows, and not the things which cast them. There had been times, of course, when she had gambled all and lost, when she had thought her heart would surely break with disappointment that reality had not exceeded or even matched her imaginings. Nina, whose belief in the concrete was almost architectural, had often advised her to expect less, the reasoning being that what she did receive would thus seem like more. Agnes considered that now, as her malicious watch told her he was 15 minutes late. She tried to imagine him coming in, flopping down uncouthly opposite her, drinking tepid vats of stinking beer until she thought his gut would explode, then belching, perhaps, a hand on her knee. So successful were the effects of this unpleasant hallucination that she began to feel rather sick. She closed her eyes, and it was then that she suddenly felt the elusive breath of him beside her, the warm, clean smell of him, the soft, expensive touch of his coat against her arm. He bent over and planted a smooth kiss on her forehead, tender as a blessing. The practiced air with which this gesture was accomplished did not entirely pass her by. She was glad he knew what to do. She had been foolish to underestimate him. He was, as she had seen when first they met, a professional. That, she hoped, was something they had in common, for a start. Chapter 5. Once Agnes had been in love, and since then she had just been in pain. The men she knew now drifted in and out of her life like ships in a harbour, some staying for a brief, inebriated night of rest and recuperation, others weighing anchor for weeks. She examined every new face for augurs of past prosperity, but her golden age had never been revived. Such traffic as she encountered, however intermittent though it was, kept her a slave to hope. Although she didn't know whether her renaissance would take the form of a resurgence of old joys or the onset of new ones, she was confident salvation was at hand. Having recognized love once, she thought she would know it again. But resemblances are cruel. Grinning skulls behind painted masks, deceiving the eye to fool the heart with empty promises. She had seen John's face in other faces, had pursued him on filthy pavements in the rain, and then stopped, duped and foolish, her chest pounding wildly with disappointment. Then she would feel herself take wing, plunging and diving and wondering if she might not find more happiness up there, among the birds and rooftops. But the pain of it dragged round after her like a ball and chain, and while she was her own jailer, he held the key. Without him, she could not contrive to escape from herself. He had made her what she was, and then he had left her. She was a house with no occupant, a church with no religion. She had never known loneliness,
until she'd had company. Agnes's father was a tall man. Like most children, Agnes had had her adoption fantasies, but as she grew older, she learned to accept her own considerable height as a natural gift, and later still to seek a man who could see eye to eye with her on such matters. Consequently, she was rather mystified when, at a party in her first term at university, she found herself accosted by an unquestionably handsome, but equally indubitably diminutive, stranger.
"I've seen you around the place," he said, smiling calmly at her in a manner which hinted that he did not find anything in her stature to suggest the conquest might be somewhat over his head. "My name's John. Some of my friends think we look alike."
She did not then or afterwards point out the obvious dissimilarity between them. He found her in the dining hall the next day and asked her to meet him later that evening. For the next 2 weeks he visited her constantly, and when he found her out, even left notes adorned with small drawings apparently etched by his own hand. Agnes took her dilemma to Nina, who, she was assured, had seen it all before. Every man had a short man inside him, Nina explained, but those whose shortness took a physical form felt that a world of injustices had been heaped upon them, for which they must be compensated. Consequently, the short man would make it his mission to have everything he felt his deficit precluded. Look, for example, at how many of the world's richest men were short. Agnes, feeling that this seminar, elegant though it was, had little relevance to her original query, took it upon herself to mention that the deficit in question was a matter merely of an inch, two at the most, and surely did not, therefore, merit such suspicions of megalomania. Nina advised her not to be deceived, but nevertheless hastened towards her point. "The spoils just mentioned," she explained, "were but the preliminaries, the foothills of the short man's Himalaya. For what, after all, was the only thing in whose procurement the short man would realistically be disadvantaged? What did the tall man automatically lay claim to? The laws of nature and attraction admitting him."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.